Hello, I welcome all the physiotherapy students of second year for the beginning of the microbiology classes. Welcome all of you in this online lecture series related to microbiology. Hello, good morning, namaskar. I am Dr. S. M. Jain from Department of Microbiology. I am beginning the teachings of the microbiology to physiotherapy students. This is the first lecture, introduction to the microbiology for you. Microbiology was a mysterious branch of science, is a mysterious science, will be mysterious science, because they are very tiny people. Those tiny organisms we are trying to look from various angles. So to many people it gives a high interest, and this is important also because we are seeing in the current pandemic situation that the impact of the microorganism is very, very high. The whole world is shaken by the pandemic of COVID-19. So this is just a brief introduction. Don't feel that this is the microbiology which is all, and there is no burden also. I don't want to give burden, because microbiology, general awareness, knowledge is needed by every citizen of the world. And you, being part of the medical services, you need specially the knowledge of the microorganisms, microbiology in the health, in the disease, so that you become comfortable with the patients, what the infection patients can transmit, what infection you can transmit, what can happen to the patient if they are suffering from a particular microbial disease, and so on, so on. So welcome all of you in this online lecture series, beginning of the microbiology for physiotherapy students. A natural good question to start a subject, what the subject is, what is microbiology, is a good question to start with. So we will see what actually microbiology is. We all know that the biology is study of the living being. In the same manner, microorganisms are very small living beings, and the study of these small living beings is microbiology. It is studied in the form of both general and applied form, and all the medical branches, including physiotherapy, nursing, dental, they all study applied microbiology, which is more aptly known as medical microbiology. So you will be learning medical microbiology. The others, in the contrast, are industrial microbiology, soil microbiology, marine biology, microbiology, which are all related to microbiology, but this is not much related to medical microbiology, so it's not of much of our concern. Man is the most intelligent creature on the earth, and he wants to know everything about everything. So whatever is existing on the earth, he wants to study, living or non-living. Accordingly, there are sciences, biological sciences, physical sciences, social sciences, geological sciences, chemical sciences, etc., etc. And microorganisms are very, very intricate part and parcel of the life, in a beneficial manner or in a harmful manner, whatever it is. So hence, all biological sciences essentially read microbiology. This question may arise that what is the need of microbiology knowledge? Why we want to learn about those tiny creatures? So this we know, that they are harmful and beneficial in various manners, and in health and sickness both, in the humans as well as in animals, this role of microorganisms is studied in the medical and veterinary sciences, and hence they are taught in the both, and there is a need to study, and this cannot be more emphasized about than this corona pandemic period, the need of the microbiology knowledge. I always wonder what actually are microorganisms and what is their role on the life on the earth. So we will see few facts here in this slide. Number one, there are variety of lives exist on the earth. Various kinds of the life forms are existing. Largest whale to smallest virus, all are part of the life on the earth. Now every creature has got its role, its place on the life on the earth. And looking at these microorganisms, it appears that they are very, very helpful in the recycling of the bio-geo elements. Bio-geo elements means the elements, major elements, or the elements which are essential components of the biological material, our bodies, plants' bodies, everyone's bodies. And carbon, nitrogen, oxygen are the main bioelements. And these organisms help recycling these elements on the earth. We'll see in the later slides how this is very, very important. Lot of more details are available, but I will not go into a greater detail. This is the poem I have written to emphasize the value and the importance and the right of the microorganisms on the earth, Jaivik Haq. You will love to see the crux of this poem. इस धरती पर सभी जीवों को जीने का अधिकार है, सभी को अपनी अपनी जिंदगी से प्यार है, सभी प्रजातियों का यहाँ मान सम्मान है, हालांकि सभी को अपना अपना ही ध्यान है, छोटे बड़े सभी का सम्मिलित यहाँ रोल है, सभी जीवों का जीवन धरती माँ के लिए अनमोल है, छोटे अक्सर बड़ों के भरोसे रहते, बड़े भी अधिकतर उनको कुछ नहीं कहते, जैविक तत्वों को घुमाने में माइक्रोब्स की खूब भूमिका, कार्बन आदि तत्वों के घूर्णन की प्रकृति ने इनको दी हुई है तुलिका, कुछ पैरासाइट, कुछ कमेंसल, कुछ पैथोजन, कुछ अलग सी महिमा वाले हैं ये सूक्ष्म जन। दिस कार्बन साइकिल इज वन ऑफ द मोस्ट इम्पॉर्टेंट कॉन्ट्रीब्यूशन ऑफ द माइक्रो ऑर्गेनिजम्स टू द नेचर। You all must have read in your earlier classes that carbon is a very central in the composition of organic material. We are all made up of organic materials. The organic carbon or the carbon on the earth is not in unlimited amounts. There is a limited amount of carbon. Now this carbon only has to be recycled in a meticulous and intelligent manner. They say that for the biological people, or we the creatures, the humans, the mammals, the birds, the fishes, for all of us only 1.5% of the total carbon available in the earth is really allotted. So with this 1.5% only we have to thrive. So what to do? Naturally, recycling is the only way out, and microbes are the rotators of this cycle. So that is their very pivotal role. Not only the carbon, other cycles are also helped by microorganisms in rotation. Pictorial depiction of the carbon cycle. The carbon dioxide is there in the air, there in the seawater. The carbon dioxide is taken by the plants, who are the primary producers. then they are consumed by the herbivorous animals who are the primary consumers. Herbivorous animals are consumed by the carnivorous animals who are secondary consumers, and all these, the primary, secondary, tertiary, all kinds of the consumers and producers ultimately die, and their dead waste products is disintegrated by various kinds of the bacteria again into carbon dioxide and other elements. This is a great carbon cycle constantly operating on the earth. This picture, although is represented for a different purpose, but my intention is to show that the matter is cycled and recycled. The matter totally available on the earth is fixed, and this matter is rotated among the various living and non-living environments. This is only known as mitti or many other names in the literature. So, panch mahabhut ki mitti. Mitti means panch mahabhut, the five elements. Panch mahabhut ki mitti ka prani ko mila sharir panch mahabhut mein samata. Jo aata hai, wo ek din chala jata. I want to zoom into the place of the microorganisms in the medical sciences, health sciences. So the question is, what health sciences do? Very good question. The paradox is that though it is called health science, personnel of medicine or physiotherapy or any other personnel related to health sciences serve mostly the disease, not the health. So to know health as well as disease is required. And to know disease, the cause and management knowledge of the disease is required. So health and disease both need to know about the various causes of the health, conditions of the health, or the causes of the disease, what causes the disease. The diseases, I am not going into the classical or the detailed definition, etc. of the disease. I am just trying to use dichotomy in dissecting the things to reach to the microorganisms. So the disease can be called of the two origin or the two types, the microbial or non-communicable, sorry, the microbial and non-microbial, also known as communicable and non-communicable. So microbial diseases, the diseases which are communicable diseases, can be of bacterial origin, viral origin, fungal origin, or parasitic origin. So that means what? That means that we are studying the disease, and the diseases are caused by the microorganisms. So in microbiology, we have to study about these microorganisms so that we know about the disease. The microfighter. We have seen so far the story of the microorganisms. What are they? Who are they? What is their role? Now, on the other side, there is an immune system. And in the nature, we are seeing every day, there is a constant organic war. All creatures, they want carbon, of course, other elements also. So they want carbon, to grab carbon for food, for energy, and for growth is their utmost requirement. So what? Then there will be a war. So war is there, organic war. So this organic war, on the other side, in the creature's body, is effected by a powerful, well-organized immune system. So there is a constant war between the two. We will see what are the results of this war. We can anticipate the war, the parties having war, and the result of the war. So if the war is not there, it's not the correct term. If there is equilibrium between the powers of the two, there is a truce, and then the health is there. And if the war is going on, really a powerful war is going on live, then there will be disease. And if the war is won by the microorganisms, the body's immune system completely loses the war, then there is a death. And if the body's immune system is powerful in due course of time after the war, the body recovers, and we say that the person, the patient has recovered from the disease. So what happens ultimately? Ultimately, if the death occurs, completely losing the war, the creature dies. There is no more life in that particular creature. The role of microorganisms very powerfully starts from here. So they are the decayers of the dead and decaying. मैं हमेशा इन लोगों को अंतिम चंडाल बोलता हूँ. माइक्रोऑर्गेनिज्म्स कुदरत के अंतिम चांडाल हैं, जो सबका क्रियाक्रम करते हैं. आखिर में हमारे क्रियाक्रम तो बहुत सारे धर्म के हिसाब से रिचुअल्स बने हुए हैं, लेकिन इनका क्या बेचारों का, जो पत्ती गिर गई पेड़ से, वो भी तो जीव थी कभी. और बहुत सारे जीव है जो मर जाते हैं, कौन उसका अंतिम संस्कार करता है? माइक्रोऑर्गेनिज्म्स करते हैं, तो वो अंतिम चांडाल है. सो अगर हम इतनी बेहद की दृष्टि से देखते हैं तो समझ में आएगा कि माइक्रो ऑर्गेनिजम्स का रोल क्या है. लुकिंग फ्रॉम वेरी हाई जनरल व्यू, माइक्रोब्स आर वाइटल रोल प्लेयर्स ऑफ द ड्रामा ऑफ लाइफ ऑन द अर्थ. दिस इज द ब्रीफ सिलेबस स्लाइड. These eight topics given in this slide are the total headings of the subject of microbiology which we will be teaching, you will be learning. The general microbiology, laboratory diagnosis of infections, immunology, systemic bacteriology, mycology, virology, parasitology and applied microbiology. The general microbiology means the basic principles of microbiology, the microscopy, the staining, the culture. These three, and of course the fourth one, the sterilization. These three, four methods are general methods which are used in every branch of the microbiology. And what are the culture media, what are the methods of the sterilization, what are the stainings, how do we do that, those all things will be studied and taught into the general microbiology. Then the purpose, as I said earlier, the purpose of the microbiology teaching learning is that ultimately we are able to diagnose the infections. So how in the laboratory the diagnosis of infectious disease can be done? So diagnosis is the second topic heading. Then as I said, the fighter, the immune system. So immunology will be taught in one heading. Then systemic bacteriology means individual bacteria will be taught to you, the details of it, the shape, the size, the cultural characteristics, the pathogenic genetic role, and other many other things related to individual bacterial character. Then same general plus systemic will be with the mycology, that is the science, the fungi, the virology, the study of the viruses, the parasites, and little applied microbiology, which is applicable to the hospital services like the hospital infection control, biomedical waste management, etc. The past, present and future are flowing continuously and influencing each other. We are indebted to our ancestors for what legacy they left for us. The current understanding and the knowledge of the microorganisms is the result of the great contributors of the past, which have built the current state of the microbiology volumes. Although there are many personalities in the history who can be given credit for the microbiology knowledge, but the Antony von Leeuwenhoek. He was probably the one who gave a milestone in the microbiology, because he was inventor of the microscope. He was a draper, simple draper, but because of his hobbies, he used to build a lot of funny things. He used to grind the glass and make the microscopes, the lenses. And because of his strange hobby, many influential princes and all, they used to come into his house, look at his work and share his discoveries. And he made it almost 500 microscopes during his lifetime, out of which some 10 or so are still alive in the Museum of the London. So Antony von Leeuwenhoek can be called father of microbiology, because he made it possible to look into the view of the microorganisms. Then many personalities came. Then the Pasteur is very significant. Louis Pasteur, he is also known as father of microbiology. He actually did a lot of work on the microorganisms. Basically, he was a chemist, the fermentation expert, but then he shifted to the microorganisms work. The major Bullard contribution of the Louis Pasteur was finishing of a great debate of that time, debate between the abiogenesis and biogenesis. In his famous swan neck flask experiment, he shut the mouth of all the people who were in favor of the abiogenesis. This experiment of swan neck proved that the life originates from life. Then Sir Joseph Lister were there. He was the introducer of antiseptic surgery. He used disinfectant during surgery, and he is also known as father of modern surgery. Then the Robert Koch, the father of bacteriology. He did a lot of work on the disease and the organism, and he laid down the rules of the organisms causing disease. Then we'll see in the later slides what those rules are there. This theories of disease is a very vast topic, but it needs a reference here. So there are many theories from the past historical period to the middle period to now. Supernatural cause theory, then the miasma theory, then the germ theory, which is led down by the Louis Pasteur and the Robert Koch, and still we are thinking of the disease in terms of the germ as a cause of disease. Then there is an epidemiological triad. This epidemiological triad concept has become very popular simultaneously with the birth of the WHO, and people think that the agent, host and environment, all the three are responsible for the origin of the disease, not a single factor. And the agents may be biological, chemical, physical or nutritional. So these four agents, if the host is susceptible and the environment is conducive, then the disease may precipitate, and vice versa. Then there is an advanced triangle of epidemiology. Then there is a web of causation theory. Web of causation theory says that the factors are interdependent, dependent on many factors are dependent to many things. So there is a web-like thing, the causation of the disease. Then there is a epidemiological wheel theory, in which there is a core hub things in the disease precipitation, and there are peripheral things in the disease precipitation. Disease occurrence theories are many, and every theory has got its role. So we will not go into those all details now. We'll see the superficial important things into it. As I said earlier, a very popular theory of disease is the agent, host and environment theory. You can see in the center of the three circles that if the agent is powerful, the host is susceptible, and the environment is favorable, then the person can be diseased. So the interaction of the three factors, the agent factors, host factors, and the environmental factors, they together will decide that the person will be in a healthy state or a diseased state. When there is a balance in the three, agent, host, environment, then there is a state of health. When there is an imbalance or disbalance between the three, there will be disease condition. This is just a depiction of a epidemiological wheel theory, where the superficial to deep causes factors are highlighted. The psychogenetic composition of the individual, then the social environment, biological environment, physical environment. If the person is very powerful and very strong mentally and physically and genetically, then he will succumb less to the disease. This is understandable. And but then the social factors, social environment is important. If there is famine or some discrepancies in the society and some person become victim, he or she is harassed, then the disease may precipitate, and so many things are there. The theories of disease are the theories of life. They all are related, match. There is a full health, maybe in the beginning, then there are changes at the molecular level. There is organic impairment, and the chronic health is impaired, the chronic disease is there, the age is there, and then the death may ensue. Coming back to the purpose of my description of the theories of the disease, because I wanted to bring the microorganisms in the picture. So you have seen the agent, host, and environment, and in the agent there are four categories of the agent: the physical, chemical, nutritional, and biological, who can be contributory to the disease. So microorganisms, microbes are the main biological agency to be agent for the causation of the disease. So this is final conclusion from the theories of the disease. Take home message from the this discussion of the theories of the disease, that the germ theory says that the germs, that is the microbes, that is the virus, bacteria, parasite, fungi, are the cause of diseases, at least of one category, that is communicable diseases. Now we will see that what is the great role of Robert Koch in the germ theory. After the discovery of the microorganisms, animalcules, tiny living animals, living molecules, by the Antony Leeuwenhoek, then the Louis Pasteur, Robert Koch became very much involved in the work on the microbes. And what causes the disease? Is it related to microorganisms or so? And he did lots of isolation of the many organisms from the various disease lesions, disease tissue. And then he established a causal relationship between the organism and the disease. And then he proposed some rules, which are popularly known as Koch's postulates. And they are the strengtheners of the germ theory. And Koch's postulates are very important for any undergraduate students or for anyone of the medical and related science to talk about the germs and the diseases they cause. So Koch's postulates are the rules which try to establish the causal role of the microorganisms to the disease. And they are proposed by the Robert Koch. So that is why, in the honor of him, we call them Koch's postulates. The Cox postulates, one of the most important short note for the undergraduate from the general microbiology. I request all of you to understand it very nicely and then mug up or whatever it is with double, triple attention. So, as I said earlier, Cox gave the proposal of the rules for the causation of the disease by a microorganism. So he proposed four criteria. One, it should be constantly associated with the lesion. What? Organism. The said organism. Two, it should be possible to isolate the organism in pure culture. From where? From the lesion, by taking the sample. Third, similar disease should occur when it is inoculated in suitable laboratory animal. That is experimental animal. If you introduce that isolated pure organism into the animal, it should produce similar disease in the animal. Then it should be possible to re-isolate the organism from the animal into pure culture. This association, isolation, inoculation, re-isolation is a scientific manner. Reproducibility is there here, which can be easily established. That is why it became a powerful, popular rules of the infection and the causation. You can remember the four words. For one, you can remember association. For two, you can remember isolation. For three, you can remember inoculation. For four, you can remember re-isolation. So these four words will help you to reproduce anytime these four Cox postulates. The fifth postulate, as the time went after the Robert Koch, the workers, the scientists saw that there is a constant finding that there are antibodies in the patient's sera. So they let down the fifth postulate. That what is it? The antibodies to that organism are found in the serum of the patient. These days we are doing a lot of tests. You must be remembering the Vidal test for the typhoid. Vidal test is an antibody test. These days also corona antibody test is being done. If the corona antibodies are found in the blood, in the serum of the patient person, then we think that the person has been infected by the coronavirus. Now, what is the value of these Cox postulates? This is a rule to establish the infection and the cause of infection. So, if you use smartly and suitably, all these postulates can help in the diagnosis of the disease. For example, if we can visualize the organism or its nuclear material from sample, from the lesion, the first postulate is obeyed. Or if you can isolate in pure culture, or you can produce similar lesion in the animal, or you can demonstrate antibodies in the serum, you can reach to the conclusion that this particular organism has caused the infection in the patient. So there is microbiological laboratory diagnostic information is achieved. So that is the value of the postulates. Here is shown your details of your syllabus, which you will be having in the subject of microbiology in this year of the BPTH. I have mentioned the major portions: the general microbiology, laboratory diagnosis, immunology, systemic bacteriology, mycology, virology, and parasitology. You can refer anytime from your syllabus and the course book provided by the college. This is the examination pattern. There will be three examinations: first term ending, then the preliminary theory, then the major university examination. All papers will be of 40 marks, 10 MCQs, four short notes, each of five. There will be choice of one, and there will be short answer question, 5 out of 6, and each will be 2 marks. So the question distribution is same throughout, and so there will be total theory marks in the internal examination of 80 marks, which will be reduced to 10 marks. So 10 marks from this, and there will be 40 marks examination of the university, so there will be total 50 marks paper. So all the very best for your further journey in the learning of microbiology. I hope you will love the learning of the microbiology. Thank you very much for a patient seeing the screens at your homes and trying to learn the microbiology. Thank you.